was about that in early years after postmodernity broke up and structuralism was challenged in the West, the reaction to it within our fraternity of cultural studies, linguistic studies, and language studies was like welcoming it with open arms. While the echoes it created within other projects of knowledge formation in the West, including the Western publication grid, mainly, you know, run by an establishment which forms, rather consists of the best academic minds and the industrial and, you know, capitalist interests. You know, they try to construct knowledge on the lines of the postmodern criticism in other spheres of knowledge. First and foremost within our own humanities and social sciences was history. You know, and here the scholars try to stop the juggernaut of postmodernity, because historiography was asked to completely transform, rather announce its own death, write a new beginning about itself. The novel as history and history as fiction. And they refused, going into the shelter already provided in theoretical premises by Habermas and others who anticipated postmodernity but did not welcome it. They refused to change historiography, because that would have been for them like accepting the role of myths, legends, and Puranic versions of historiography of Indian subcontinent and the folk and oral cultures of Africa as valid source of history. And that would have turned the Western historical constructions undertaken throughout the course of history upside down. The whole history of the world would have been rewritten, and many historical notions would have been thrown to the dustbin of the times in order to be replaced by certain better history which validates alternative and complementary source of historiography. And therefore, the last discipline within the discourses of humanities and social sciences was history, to give some space to postmodern reflections. Even now, you will be surprised that postmodern historiography, metafictional historiography, interreferential historiography are not the topics which are covered substantially in Western history departments as methodological discourses. Come to organize knowledge disciplines like science and technology departments, bearings of postmodernity, which in turn invoked reflection over Achebe Chinua Achebe Wole Soyinka's mystic Yoruba thoughts of non-duality, also Shankar's non-dualistic Vedanta, Ashutosh Shunyavada, Ramanujan's qualified non-dualism, all these things, and a great Sufi undercurrent of mysticism.
That's it.
Where the trance or the sama was all about reaching the signified, was almost like Satchidananda of, you know, non-duality. So that Sufi, all these alternative currents of knowledge and meaning would have been brought into mainstream canon. The thing was, pure and applied sciences, the organized knowledge sphere, refused to decanonize itself in the late 70s and 80s after the, you know, advent of postmodernity and post-structuralism. Only discipline which accepted the attack as addition to its own moorings was English literature, language and cultural studies, you know, academia and the criticism sphere, where it was, I mean, taken up with open arms, where people were so ready and open-minded to change them their ways. Rather, every youngster took pride in knowing the fact that there was nothing like finality about meaning, that there can't be anything which could be undertaken as the final truth. And they were rather more settled with this notion of meaning than being unsettled. What was happening in other spheres of knowledge was they were unsettled.
Sir, paper. I have not taken my paper.
G1 or G2?
G1.
You come tomorrow.
Okay, sir. Sir, at which time?
Lunch time, you know, around 2 you come, isn't it?
Okay, sir. Thank you.
And Professor, just as you said, like, we had already discussed about how Zen became part of Western intellectual movement in 1980s, about Osho's influence in America, and not only that, there are quite a lot of books comparing Zen to science, Tao and
Shintoism, Taoism,
Taoism, and fictionalized work like Zen and the Art of Motorcycling.
Mm-hmm.
All those things, like, I'm able to relate how this somewhere at one point, I won't say non-duality, something beyond meaning, was people boldly made an attempt to at least, especially the Westerners, to include it into science and arts.
They tried, and it was very late. In fact, when quantum physics and even nanotechnology, and there are so many other diseases.
Yes.
In fact, what I am saying and what I am referring to is the initial failure of the West to recognize the significance of their own meta theory.
Yes, sir.
Which was taken up far and received in far better and constructive terms by the Eastern academia.
Exactly.
And African. Because see, the Orient was first to welcome Derrida. If you go by the empirical evidences, who welcomed first, you know, all those deaths of history, that's in fact the East and the Orient. But the trouble was that in the West there was a clear picture of a divided academia. Only English and cultural studies, and a bit supported by a good section of philosophy departments, which were influenced by the French philosophical movement represented by Derrida. And Derrida has his followers in the West. Others were guided by Husserl's approach, whom Derrida contradicted. And therefore, they were conventional, you know, Habermas movement. So, it was like departments like JNU, you know, where a certain Meenakshi Mukherjee declared that people are not located and still they are writing reality of India, like Rushdie. And I refuse to consider them Indian writers, Naipaul. They are not Indian writers. They are not rooted. Their novels can't be read as cultural critiques or historical material. Of course, there can be histories within Indian novel, but the writer's location must be tested. And when she gave this keynote in the first convention of international, you know, post-colonial studies, you know, association conference in London, I mean, vistas were open. But, and she welcomed otherwise postmodern, isn't it? But she says, I'm ready to give the status of historiography to all our novels, but then I will test people within the framework provided by, you know, neo historicism, where rootedness, location and commitment of an author is to be tested. Because you just cannot say that in the name of hybridity, multiculturalism, you will start writing histories of the places you do not belong. And you will say that I am into imaginary homelands, that see, this is that or that. She was not ready to, you know, give them a status which she otherwise ready to give to R.K. Narayan or you are Anant Murthy's Sanskar. She says, this is history. I have a copy of that lecture in Bangalore, I think, because that was the seminal first Indian scholar speaking in an international platform about this whole revolt, you know. And there she says, yeah, I welcome, but I don't think, I am rather more sad than happy when I find whole of the globe, you know, giving the status of a historiographer and so readily to a certain Rushdie, and on the blurb of Midnight Children you find out that better read this book as a novel about Indian history than reading so many histories of modern India, because it's giving you a better view. That's written. She quoted. I don't think he's Indian. V.S. Naipaul, twice removed from reality. Isn't it? First to Trinidad and then to England, and then having a claim over, you know, writing about a million mutinies. What kind of reality are you constructing of India? Have you ever been a witness to what transpires within that subcontinent size space, civilizational space, which India is? Isn't it? As compared to hybridized, you know, almost diaspora realities within which you have come to live. How can you imagine those socio-cultural institutions which are in your fainted glim memory, but not as historical evidence? I mean, in what ways, you know, an enigma of arrival is history? It's reflection of somebody who's twice removed from reality about a past which he tries in vain to prove as present. Isn't it? Or Rushdie's critique of India based on the poor, fainted memories of a four-year child who could not live in Bombay beyond 4 years, had to migrate himself to Lahore, and from there also at the age of 9 or 8 perhaps was transported to England, and that was all, based on which he says this comes from life, this comes from blood, this comes from memories. Of course, then you say that I have these sources, based on these sources I am constructing a reality, but then you take delight in using imaginative reality, the all-pervasive existence of an imaginative reality which is the preserve of a novelist or literary artist, isn't it? So you don't have to cite your sources, but you do cite, and you say my life is my source. What life? Life of a 4 years child is all that you say, and then you have comments on everything about the making of the nation, and then you say this is a subcontinent, I'm quoting rather Rushdie in imaginary homelands, a subcontinent size mass of a people, not a nation, a non-stop assault on our imagination, senses and mind. That is India. I fail to understand what it is, because it did not exist earlier on the night of 14th August, before the dawn of 15th. It came from nowhere and was converted into a nation. This is the imperfect sympathy with which you start writing about a nation, and then you have the claim that you are the historian of that nation. I mean, where are you located? This was a seminal question Meenakshi Mukherjee raised. Class over.
Stop.
This is endless. ये तो चलता ही रहेगा.
This is interesting. This is